Good day, fellow geeks. On this week's episode of Geeks of Azeroth, we're going to be talking about Legion, big StarCraft 2 changes that we literally just found out about, and Matt's Big Voodoo's freaking out about it, and of course, a movie? Yeah, all that and more in this week's episode of Geeks of Azeroth. Geeks.
About geeks.
For geeks.
Welcome to Geeks of Azeroth.
Hello, hello, welcome to the show. My name is Tarly, and with me, as always, I've got Big Voodoo and Britza. How's it going, gentlemen?
It's going very well. It's not as warm down here in the UK as, or over here in the UK. Down here, it's going well.
Going well. Big Voodoo, start with you. How's your week in gaming been? Let's not go over hype right now. Let's not freak out. We'll get there. Okay. We'll get there.
My week in gaming's been good. I've been taking part in lots of demon invasions. To put it shortly, my characters could probably have killed the Legion single-handedly at this point.
What we like to hear. So it's solved. That's it.
Yeah.
Legion's over. You saved us all.
It's over. He stopped the Burning Legion by himself. We can all go home. Let's keep playing Warlords of Draenor.
Oh, God, don't say that.
What about you, Britza? What have you been doing this week?
Completely the same thing. Been doing the Legion invasion on the Alliance and the Horde side. And because I've been trying to do the Horde side, it's kind of made me fall back in love with my priest. So, whilst I don't think I'm going to main
Shadow.
I'm actually playing Holy. Uh-huh. As main. I wanted to get back into the Holy scene for raiding. But I'm thinking, like, after I've done maybe my Pally as my first character, I might turn to Priest afterwards, because I'm really liking that sort of play again. But saying that, I'm still trying to figure out how to play it. I mean, the concept of DPSing for disc is just really freaking me out a bit.
Yeah. I do apologize if you hear the random knocking sounds. That's just my happy dog beating his tail against the floor. So.
Oh.
Yeah, I've been doing much of the same. You know, the invasions, playing my Demon Hunter. It's been a lot of fun. Playing still a lot of beta. Been playing some max level content and getting the feel for that. What else have I been doing? No Man's Sky. So that also came out this week. A lot of fun. I love No Man's Sky. I just want to talk about that a little bit because there's so much controversy about the game, and I don't understand why. Everybody's like, they promised us so much, and it's none of this, and it's like it's everything you expected it to be. It's 18 quintillion planets, and you go around and gather materials, find better ships, and try to get to the center of the galaxy. And I think just the scale of the game just blows my mind every time I play it. Flying into these massive planets and seeing other planets up in the sky, and I found a black hole last night, and it was crazy.
How did you react to that?
I went through it.
Can you do that?
Yep, and it shoots you like way closer towards the center if that's your end goal. So, yeah.
Oh, geez, that's cool.
Yeah, 500 or so light years, 500 million light years rather. It's crazy. But yeah,
I guess. There was so much hype. There was so much hype about that game, you know, before it was released.
I think the best analogy I've heard for the game is it's like having 18 quintillion bowls of spaghetti without any sauce.
Oh. Oh.
But yeah, which I do see, like, there's controversy that it is a AAA game. Like, $60 is a huge price tag for this game because when it boils down to it, there is not a whole lot of content on these planets. Like, ultimately, you're doing the same thing on every planet you go to. So I do get the controversy, but I guess I still like the game and some people don't like the game.
You get to enslave alien populations to your will.
Eventually, that would be nice.
Yes, that is good.
I have seen, like, because all the animals are also procedurally generated, I've seen something that looked like a stegosaurus with butterfly wings, and I had no idea what was going on. So, I mean, just random stuff like that, and it's pretty hilarious, so.
It's funny you mentioned No Man's Sky, though, because I think a lot of people were talking about that, and then they dropped the Rogue One trailer, and then it kind of nuked. Yeah. Like, Star Wars has this tactic of just waiting for something big and then just kind of dropping it.
There you go, this is better.
There you go.
So, Big Buddha, have you seen that yet?
No, I haven't yet.
Well, spoilers, because I'm going to talk about it anyway. And spoilers to anybody else who hasn't seen it. Just, I mean, Britta, were you surprised what they dropped there at the end of the trailer?
I was really hoping. I think it would have been such a letdown if one person wasn't in there.
I was really expecting them to hold off on showing Vader until the movie.
No, I wanted that glimpse.
It was totally a surprise to me anyway. I mean, it's like less than two seconds, like back of Vader's head and then end of trailer. But so there he was. Confirmation, he's in the movie.
Spoiler, they get to steal the plans.
Spoiler, Vader is Luke's father. All right, well, jumping right in, it's time for... Uh-oh, where'd the Sounders go? There they are. It's time for News of the Week.
Hey, we recording? Yeah? Okay.
News of the Week.
That's right, it's time for News of the Week. It's pretty tricky to keep control of my Sounders when my desktop is so cluttered. Just like my room, I just keep stuff everywhere. Yes? No? Anyone? Okay, well, jumping right into News of the Week. I don't think anything's really happened for World of Warcraft. Lots of stuff going on in Diablo, though. Diablo Season 7 started, and that's all the news for the week.
See you later.
Bye. That's the show. No, but for real, the demon invasions have begun and the demon hunters are available for play. This has been a huge week for World of Warcraft. I mean, all three of us have probably spent more time in World of Warcraft this week than we have spent collectively in Warlords of Draenor.
That's probably quite close.
Yeah, almost.
I mean, I feel like I'm having way more fun in this short amount of time than I have had in the whole of Warlords of Draenor. That's certainly true.
So, I mean, we'll go ahead and just talk about just the Broken Shore. Just go right off the bat talking about that. That happened. So, full spoilers, if you have not done that yet, you've obviously been living in a rock, or under a rock, or I guess in a rock, I guess. That's possible, too. The kings are dead. Both war chiefs, Horde and Alliance, they're gone. They are out of the picture. King Varian and Vol'jin. I didn't actually see Vol'jin coming. That surprised me. What do you guys think? I mean, this was huge. I mean, those cinematics in the Broken Shore were phenomenal, right?
They were phenomenal. So, my favorite thing about the Broken Shore is I now feel more powerful than any other hero in the game.
You don't even have your artifact yet.
Yeah, but, so hear me out here. All of this bad stuff's happening. Sylvanas runs away and carries the Horde with her. But how difficult was that for you? Like, everyone, all the leaders are freaking out because there's so many of them. And all the players were just sitting there like, yeah, we could be doing this for days.
That's true. But I mean, I think you and I were talking about this earlier in the week. I mean, from a lore standpoint, it's crushing. Like, this is a crushing defeat for both the Horde and Alliance. And we haven't seen this yet. Like, so far, that we've just stood triumphant over everything we've come across. But we've had to retreat. We've lost our leaders. Like, this is something we haven't experienced yet. What do you think, Britza?
Yeah, I think one of the things that really stood out for me is, in a sense, you kind of need to play both.
Yeah.
And I think anyone who just plays Alliance...
You're going to hate the Horde if you just play the Alliance.
You're going to hate, yeah. And that's the thing, is that you get this picture on the Alliance side that really makes the Horde look like real, you know, pieces of rubbish. And then you see what the Horde was actually doing when they sort of turn away from that cliff. And you realize, oh, I see what was going on here. And you can start to see how the story's going to be like It's going to be about how Gen Greymane is going to really misunderstand the situation and how Sylvanas is probably going to feel threatened by him. And you can see how this conflict is going to come out of misunderstanding. And I really like that. I think that's kind of old-fashioned style Horde versus Alliance diplomacy. You know, they're not really bad guys. Exactly. They just don't. They think each other's, you know, doing the wrong thing.
Yeah.
But the thing that really stood out for me is, when did we get multiple airships? When did that become a thing?
As the Alliance? Oh, we've been building them since Pandaland, I guess.
I thought we only had one, but I guess maybe I just wasn't paying enough attention. But what I thought, like, when the opening cinematic like happens, or the introductory cinematic happened, I thought, okay, fair enough, that's it, we haven't got any airships now. And then and then that one turns up at the end and I'm like, oh, okay, never mind, I guess we've got loads. So that's pretty cool. It might be the case Blizzard listened to us a few weeks ago when we said an airship for everyone.
Yeah, there you go. Blizzard listening to us. I mean, just there's proof everywhere. So jumping up like around the same time point that this is all happening, Maiev Shadow Song is breaking the Demon Hunters out of the vault of the Wardens because she needs their help. So that whole introductory sequence where you're basically starting off as a Demon Hunter at the same timeline as Black Temple. Basically, Illidan sends you to go kill some demons on their world while he fights us, basically, at Black Temple. That whole intro sequence was so much better. I mean, Big Voodoo and I both had done it multiple times, but being able to do it with the cinematics made such a huge difference in seeing that whole first-person cinematic when Maiev is waking you up. So cool.
Yeah, it was the storytelling for the Demon Hunter starting experience is amazing.
Yeah.
Same with the Broken Shore. Like, the story Blizzard is telling at this point, I don't think we've seen anything like it in all of WoW. Maybe a little bit in Warlords with the Thrall and Grosh storyline. But, I mean, that was, like, one cutscene and so brief, like, throughout the entire story. But now, this is perfect.
And, I mean, totally lost my train of thought there. So, Britz, I think you were going to say something.
I will say what you were thinking. I mean, the storytelling is absolutely fantastic. And I think as well, that scene where you, as the Alliance player, I think more particularly, is when, you know, Gul'dan's talking to you and, you know, all the demon bosses start appearing. Even Tychondris is there. You just realize, you know what? These are actually, like, I realize they kind of did the same thing with Warlords, and you're like, oh my god, they're all the, you know, the famous orcs we've heard about and lived with. But these guys, like, honestly, it feels like you're up against, like, the meanest and baddest that they can throw at you in terms of all enemies. So I'm really excited.
Do you think we could see the Avatar of Sargeras come back? That, what's her name? I can't remember the name of the guardian that killed him.
I'm pulling a blank
book here, but yeah.
Let us consult the tome.
I could totally see a Gul'dan going to the depths of the tomb of Sargeras and resurrecting the Avatar. It could be interesting.
Definitely.
I just read that part this morning of Chronicle. Like, was reading through that, and I'm like, oh, he could come back. But
yeah. I'm still hoping for the, like, logic loop of Gul'dan with Gul'dan's skull.
Right.
Illidan's going to consume himself a new Gul'dan.
Just drives himself mad looking into his own skull.
It'd be interesting to see what Illidan does. I guess the question is, obviously, like you said, Tali, we kind of lose Varian and we lose Fol'jin. And admittedly, we lose them in very different ways. You know,
Tyrion Fordring as well. He's dead.
Oh, yeah. And Fordring, which I think really hit me hard. But, you know, he really gets hurt. And I realized, like, he probably plays although I haven't seen it, he plays probably quite a big part.
He forgot to bubble.
I mean, well, he forgot the bubble only lasts 10 seconds.
he needed the Lawbringer set, Bubble Hearth.
Yeah.
Yes. That's why we're the heroes.
We know how to do that stuff.
But I guess, how did you think about the way they went? I mean, Varian's obviously, you know, really quick. You get that moment with Gul'dan, and it's painful, and he literally rips him apart. And I've put something out on Twitter about whether it could be like a Bolvar returning sort of thing. Whether we'd fight him as a boss, and I think a lot of people have, you know, clarified, no, he's been blown into a million bits. So
I liked my idea that I had before the show, that he'll just be a mount, Fel Corrupted Varian, and you ride around on his shoulders. And same thing with Vol'jin for the Horde, Fel Corrupted Vol'jin. You just get a piggyback ride.
He carries you like one of those treasure goblins. No,
I mean, his death was very reminiscent of the movie when Gul'dan killed, can't think of his name now. God, what was this?
Durotan?
Durotan, yeah. When he kills Durotan, just sucking the life out of him. It was very reminiscent of that. But, I mean, Varian definitely died a hero's death. I Vol'jin kind of just got shanked and then, like, slowly died. So it was, I think Vol'jin kind of had it worse off. At least Varian died, like, you know, saving the whole bunch of people, you know.
I think I liked Vol'jin's one. That's the thing. I think in some ways I liked his a little bit more because... I think that idea of him being able to pass on the baton, probably. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, they both of them are about them passing on the baton. Mm-hmm. You know, Varian does it through that note to his son. But I just like the idea that, you know, all the leaves of the Horde gathered round him mm-hmm. during those last few moments. And that sort of scene, because you get, unlike the others, unlike the Alliance, sorry, you get an extra cut scene with Sylvanas and the leaders. And I think that's just, you get to learn a lot about her and how she never expects to lead the Horde, and in some ways, she's a little bit taken back, but she's ready to do it. And I think that was just so much extra character. I wish they'd done something for the Alliance, I guess, is what I'm trying to say. Like, something to do with Anduin or...
Yeah, it is weird that... I mean, because there is the whole sequence. You go as the Alliance, and you go and you turn it in. That really could have been a cutscene like the Horde got, with all the Alliance leaders coming and just consoling Anduin. And Anduin accepting his role as king could have been a cinematic in itself. But, oh, well.
I guess you got a comic...
we got the but yeah, I mean, and then jumping right in, then after that we get to do the invasions now happening every 4 hours right now in two different places at once, and those are really cool. I mean, what do you guys think? It's just really cool to see, and I've seen a lot of people comment about this, that it's World of Warcraft feels like an MMO again. Like, there's just people out doing the world content for the first time in since the launch of Draenor. And it really tapered off since then. I mean, this is fantastic to see so many people.
I don't know if even the launch of Draenor was like this. I mean, the launch of Draenor had a bunch of people playing, but everyone was playing inside their kind of like their own little bubble at that point because of the garrison and everything. But now you've got players all over the place coming together for these invasions and all taking part in the exact same content. In a shared zone.
Alliance working together, unless you're on a PvP server, then it's madness.
it is madness.
But yeah, I mean, it's just so cool. I mean, Britza, what do you think?
I totally agree. I think one of the things I've always found, playing the Invasion Quest is that you're right, it does feel like an MMO, but the thing is, no one's sitting there and like yelling out invite please, or no one's forming raid groups for this sort of thing. Yeah. It's just people turning up randomly, and it's like, it's almost intuitive. You can all just join in. Like when you go, you see like the bosses all spread out across, say, the crossroads. Mm-hmm. And, you know, some of you will peel off to fight one boss, and other people will peel off to go fight another area, and you just kind of follow with people, and it's just, it feels so natural.
It feels so cool to be, like, flying through the skies on your mount with, like, an army of people flying with you. It just feels epic, almost. You know, in a sense, I mean, from what I've played of Legion anyway, even with the small beta population, there's just such a great sense of camaraderie? I don't know if that's the right word, but just everyone working together without grouping up, without even feeling the need to say, hey, party up with me. You're just working together naturally, and it shows that now, and it shows that in Legion as well. I mean, it's just, the game feels better than it ever has, and this is just a pre-event.
I will say, on PvP servers, it's much more common that groups get formed.
True, true.
But that's out of necessity more than anything.
You can't stand in melee range on a PvP server without just blowing up.
Yeah. AoE damage will destroy you.
On a complete side note, I will say that having everyone playing Demon Hunter at the moment has done wonders for my queue time as a healer.
I can imagine. If you go into a battleground, I mean, you'll see a lot of purple people. It's pretty silly, it's just, but yeah, Demon
Hunter. I think you just end up with the inevitable Demon Hunter versus Demon Hunter smash up in the middle.
I mean, and it's pretty funny right now because Demon Hunters are pretty easy to kill in Battlegrounds because they don't have their full toolkit or their weapons that they're balanced around. So just play any of your other characters in a Battleground, you'll have a fun time killing a Demon Hunter.
No better way to spend the invasion event than squishing Demon Hunters.
Yeah. That being said, Demon Hunters can just fly away from everything. So, only monks can catch up to them.
One other thing about the invasion events, I think, I don't know what the name of them is, but those flying ships, those fell ships, I think just having them, the demon spaceships, but I think just having them, like, in a sense, it's a bit like, for me, how the Fell Reavers were in Outland, because you can see them in the distance, and you realize, right, I've got to get over there and do something. And I think that's just so cool. Again, it makes the world feel a lot bigger. And I think, yeah, you're right, Big Video, with the garrisons, we've got used to seeing things very close to us and reacting to that. But it's been a long time since we've seen anything in the distance and felt, oh, I need to get over there with these other 10 people and start beating up some, Legion demons.
So, and another pro tip, I mean, if you've got characters that you want to level really quickly, because you can do the demon invasions at level 10, you can start. So if you get an Elixir of the Rapid Mind, at least from 1 to or 10 to 60, you get 10 levels per invasion.
What?
Yeah. One Elixir of the Rapid Mind, 15 minutes is what it lasts, and they're done in 15 minutes. So one potion, 10 levels from 1 to 6, or 10 to 60.
Jesus.
Yeah. So, and then even 60 to 70, you get at least 5. Then 70 to 80, you're getting, 2 or 3 per invasion. So, I mean, you think about this. In an afternoon, you're going to be from, 1 to up to 90 very quickly.
As soon as the invasions are more common, at least.
Yeah. Traveling around is going to be the pain. Mm. But, yeah, very quickly we will see those invasions happening just constantly instead of being on a cooldown. So.
Great.
Yeah, characters, and I mean, those elixirs are pretty expensive. They're like 5k a piece, so they're a little bit spendy if you want to use them all for leveling, but Big Voodoo
still thinking. it beats spending $60 on a character beast.
Yeah, that's true.
I don't have a hunter yet.
I would do that, but I just spent all of my gold on that Grand Yak, the Expedition Yak. It was 120k gold. That was like all I had coalesced from running the raids every single week, and I have to get my gold back.
Oh, it's a good investment.
It is. Now I can transmog wherever I want to.
I can too.
Moocher.
Thanks for that.
I can't.
So we'll hop over to US.
That might be the most expensive way to do my transmogs, but fair point.
What was I going to say? Thinking. Oh, yeah. So another thing that's going to be happening over the weeks is, of course, a storyline that's going to be leading up to Legion. You'll get some quests from Khadgar and a few others starting on Tuesday. Patch day is when everything happens like that. So I'm assuming that quest will start then. They were supposed to do the introductory to Dalaran being moved over Karazhan, but Blizzard kind of just patched Dalaran being over Karazhan and didn't say anything to anybody. So you can actually fly to Karazhan right now if you didn't know this, and Dalaran is there, new Dalaran. You can go and you talk to the NPCs and they have dialogue about being dizzy from the move and they don't have anything to sell to you yet, but it's in the game.
That was a bit under the radar, yeah.
There's a gnome, there's a little Easter egg, there's a gnome that's stuck in the wall and they're like another gnome's trying to pull him out from the blink. So it's pretty funny.
Is there actually anything to do in Dalaran? No, like, have they got all no the quests, vendors there and everything?
All the vendors have like dialogue that says they have nothing to sell because they're dizzy from the blink and they have to resort their stuff, something like that. So
okay, makes me wonder why they bothered doing it, I guess, other than sort of as a teaser.
Well, that's what I'm wondering, if maybe it wasn't supposed to be patched in until you got the Khadgar quest and it was just suddenly there, because there's no indication that it's there. It's not on the map. It's you just fly over Karazhan and look up and there's Dalaran.
Hmm.
What else about these invasions? What am I missing? What have I not talked about? Oh, there's also the little thing that you can turn other people into dreadlords going around. That's really annoying in the main city.
and one thing I've realized you can do, because I was doing this last night. If you when that sort of corrupted mind thing kicks in, if you see someone who's transported into a demon and then use the ability that takes on their form, you'll turn into a demon, or the appearance of a demon, and then you can right-click the buff, which gets rid of the corrupted mind feat, but leaves you looking as a demon. So I was wandering around Stormwind, and I had no way to turn off the demon look. And the funniest thing is, when you mount up, you turn into a pally. So you turn back into your normal form. So as a pally, I was flying around thinking, oh, really, I've got rid of this thing. I'll fly into the mage tower. I unclicked it, and then boom. And I couldn't see anything. and the model, the size of your model stays the same as a human. So you're walking through all these doors and it's just this demon morphing through the wall. So it kind of freaked me out. And I imagine it freaked a lot of people out because I was just walking around as a demon for no real reason.
Wow.
So that's a bit of fun. Enjoy that before that gets bugged.
Wow. Well, anything else on the demon invasions and demon hunters before we move on to some other lesser news for the week?
No, it's going really well. Yeah, really well.
Really start. Excited yeah. for Legion. It's going to be awesome. All right, so a little bit of news here. There's going to be a Bastion cinematic at Gamescom. For Bastion is in Overwatch, if you didn't know that by now. So we haven't had a cinematic since the Soldier 76 one before the launch of Overwatch, so this will be a new one starring our favorite little robot, Bastion. I hope he's narrating it the whole time, just beeping, beep, beep, boop, boop, you know, saying his hello and everything, because he's adorable. I hope his bird comes into play as well.
I'm sure it will. Bird's in the, like, art for the announcement.
Yeah. But anyway, that will be August 18th at 9 a.m. Pacific time. That's, 7 in the morning my time. So I'll be getting up for that.
Like any true fan.
Right. Gamescom is in Europe. That is why the times are so wonky for us U.S. people.
How do you think we feel with the Olympics?
How do you think we feel with the Olympics? We can't even watch them, and we live in the States.
Can you not?
For anybody in the United States, there's only one way you can watch them, and that is through NBC. So anybody who wants to watch them online or anything like that, you're just tapered off. I mean, all other regions have all these different ways to watch the Olympics, but we have one way, and that is paying NBC to watch it online or having it through cable.
Jeez.
Get on my spoiler, level, bro.
You guys are winning, I'll tell you that much.
Michael Phelps. I mean, I saw a pretty funny joke about him, the swimmer. He's winning a lot of medals. And it was a reference from SpongeBob where he put seaweed, or Plankton put seaweed into the computer and it throws up on the screen what seaweed is. And it's the same thing for Michael Phelps. It's 50% sea, 50% weed.
Oh, well, it was getting tough. I know we're not supposed to talk about the Olympics on this show, but it was getting tough about 3 or 4 days in when Michael Phelps had more medals than the whole of Team GB.
Yeah,
that was a tense moment. Anyways,
so Bastion, Bastion coming out on the 18th. That should be an interesting cinematic either way, whatever they're talking about. Or beeping.
Do you
about.
Think it's going to be? I mean, it talks about how he's going to sort of go out exploring and then realize that his combat protocols are going to mess things up for him. So I imagine he's probably going to end up massacring a bird or something like that in front of everyone and something. I don't know.
It might be just terribly sad. What if he shoots his little bird that he has like flying around?
Yeah, boop, boop, beep, you know.
Sad people.
You realize what happens to Siri when it gets annoyed with you.
Maybe he'll be trying to fight Torbjorn. Torbjorn will try to like hammer him into shape or something. Who knows?
Turn him into a can vendor or something like that.
Something.
All of these though have got a really good balance between sort of the nice hot, you know, feel good stuff and the darker tone. They're kind of, I don't know, on the sort of darker edge of Pixar. in some ways.
The darker edge of Pixar.
All yeah. Right.
Have you seen Up? The first 10 minutes of that movie was devastating.
The first 7 minutes are a comedy, and the rest is the depressing bit.
Anyway, we're getting sidetracked today like crazy.
Yeah, we are.
Moving on, next bit of news. Blizzard released another live-action video like they do from time to time, and this one was an Azeroth army forging the Doomhammer. Britzel, you brought this to our attention. What do you think about this?
Yeah, I mean, in context, the link's in the notes. It's very much like how they've done with previous armories, in that they are making a famous weapon from the game, and this time it's Doomhammer. I think it's probably quite interesting they're doing that now. And in some ways, I wonder whether they had this ready at the time of the movie, and have simply delayed it, or I'm not really sure. But I guess it's an artifact weapon in Legion, so it's just as relevant now. But they go through the whole sort of design process, and in some ways, I don't want to spoil it because it really is fascinating to watch how they put this together. But the final design is absolutely gorgeous. It is not quite fully full weight, but you know, they start smashing, you know, skulls and watermelons with it. You know, appropriate things to smash with the Doomhammer. And the great thing is, well, they've designed it on one of the. I don't know which skin it is, but it might be a PvP skin, or it might be, but it's one of the alternate skins you can get for Doomhammer in Legion.
I mean,
so it's great.
Yeah, I mean, I love watching these things. I can't. There's a show on YouTube, you know, where these guys make all these weapons, and it is pretty cool to subscribe to that anyway. So seeing Warcraft stuff being made, especially the Doomhammer, is just cool to see.
In some ways, I'm upset they didn't do the Warblades.
I'm looking at the Doomhammer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Sorry. I'm interested in trying to keep myself from screaming about StarCraft 2 changes.
Okay. Well, I guess, without further ado, yeah. I mean, anything else on the Doomhammer?
No, let's get into StarCraft.
Oh, wait. I didn't even see this other topic you have here, though.
I'll very quickly buzz through this because I don't want to keep you fully waiting. So we were going to talk about the Warcraft movie, but in some ways, I think we were going to originally have a discussion on what the future of Warcraft was based on the final, the numbers, the amount of money it made, because its future looks a little bit in doubt.
No,
but
I meant the HoloLens topic here.
Yeah, the thing that I've picked up is that the Microsoft HoloLens is doing a partnership with Legendary Pictures, and I don't know that much about the HoloLens, but it seems to be sort of a very advanced version of... I think even Google Glass is just something... It isn't good enough to explain it, but it's very much like a VR headset, but it's not... You don't get closed off from the world.
It's what you call AR. So augmented reality, basically changing what's in your world instead of putting you in a different world. The best example they've shown is being able to play Minecraft on a table. Like you have your entire Minecraft world basically laid out as if it was a board game, and that's and you can walk around it and look at characters moving around when they're actually playing the game. Pretty fantastic technology, kind of something you'd see in Tony Stark's living room, I guess.
Exactly.
Anyway,
and Legendary Pictures have sort of teamed up along with another number of other studios, and it seems that it's going to be the case that Warcraft movie characters are going to be things that you can interact with and sort of mess about with the headset. And the idea is that you can sort of control them, manipulate them, and use that to sort of create short clips to share with your friends. For example, you could have like Durotan and Gul'dan fighting on your desk at work.
I'm looking at this video right now. This is fantastic.
It's amazing, and it's really worth checking out. But what I wanted to suggest was we always wondered, what a shame it would be not to do a Warcraft 2, because they spent all the money. All the money went towards designing these characters and designing these models. And in some ways, at least we know they're going to be put to some use, even if Warcraft 2 doesn't come about. But really exciting stuff. And I guess in some ways, it's the closest thing we're going to get to a Warcraft Go anytime soon.
Yeah. This alone kind of justifies the HoloLens to me anyway. I mean, when you look at the characters sitting on the desk, it reminds me of Star Wars, the chess board on the Millennium Falcon is what that reminds me of. I don't know, that's so cool. I have to buy a HoloLens now as soon as like a real version one is available.
And I guess, like, things... I know Pokemon Go is a really basic version of what this is, but at least we know the technology is roughly there and sound, and it can work.
Pokemon Go so, would be so much better in the HoloLens. Like, if
I can imagine...
Yes, it would.
Yeah. All right, well, we're not going to hold Big Voodoo back anymore. It's time to take the leash off. We're going to go right into discussion of the week.
Sweep down from above. I tell ya, you should have seen the size of those wangs. I swear, Borondax could hardly cut through a gnome. What's a Drenna anyhow? Can I drink it?
Discussion of the week.
All right, Big Voodoo, it's time for discussion of the week, and we're gonna let you take the reins and charge forward.
So, as of, like, less than an hour ago, or maybe slightly over an hour ago now, because you guys made me wait a while, Blizzard posted a lot of plan changes to multiplayer units for StarCraft, and when I mean quite a few, I mean a lot of changes. They could be incredibly impactful.
Delayed us starting the show. I mean, we were like about to start the show. We started reading this, and then both, like, all three of us were just like sitting here reading, like, "Oh my god."
But at any rate, so talking broadly about Terran, it looks like they want mech to be a much more viable strategy.
And we never see mech.
It's been used more often recently, but you're right, mech isn't super popular. But they changed the Cyclone again, reduced, I think they increased overall damage against armored, slightly decreased damage towards other stuff, and now it hits a lot more frequently. Which means Cyclones definitely will not deal with Ultralisks anymore.
Thankfully.
They can't shoot air anymore, but their lock-on now only affects air. Let's see here.
They can't shoot air, but they can still lock on to air?
So, their ability lock-on can hit air, but their regular attacks cannot hit air. But they can't use their lock-on ability with ground units.
I haven't played enough Terran and Legacy of the Void to even, like, really know how the Cyclone works, so...
It was terrible damage with normal attack. Lock-on did really good damage. Now it's... Their regular attack is for ground, and it does pretty good damage. And lock-on is for air, and it does ridiculous damage, is what it looks like. But probably the biggest change that affects this making mech more viable is...
Make mech great again!
One supply cost reduced on them from 4 to 3, so they're a lot more supply efficient to build now. With increased health to 180 from 120, so, you know, a 50% boost to health. And... you can now build them with a reactor instead of having to have a tech lab on the factory. Ridiculous changes.
Yeah.
That's just the first change. Siege tanks now do a lot more damage. +5 damage versus regular units. +20 damage versus armored units. Compared to what they were. But... no one has to deal with tankovacs anymore. Or metatanks. Or whatever you want to call it. They can't be lifted anymore. While in siege mode. Liberators and Thors saw slight changes. Thors are a little bit better at killing air stuff. Liberators are a little bit worse. Banshees... no longer require a fusion core to research hyperflight rotors, which is the one that makes them pretty quick, like I'm pretty sure they're the fastest unit in the game with that upgrade, actually. Don't quote me on that. Might be wrong.
Quote him on that, everybody.
Quote me on it. Vikings now get plus 8 damage versus mechanical units. In ground mode only. And the battlecruiser no longer will have energy. Instead, it has just cooldowns with its abilities. Cooldowns are not shared between the abilities. So Yamato Cannon and Tactical Jump can be used once every 71 seconds each. Raven had its auto turret damage decreased from 6, or increased from 16 to 24. So it's a little bit better at dealing with stuff. And that is about it for Terran.
Whew. Okay, moving on.
Okay.
So, Terran, any thoughts?
Mech. Mech is looking very strong. But, I mean, I'm not a... I guess I'm better at Terran than I am at Protoss, but really the only changes that I can really comment on are Zerg, because they're the only ones I'll ever be interested in playing, really. So.
All right.
What about you?
Brits. Mech looks... Okay.
In some ways, I'm trying to think about how significant the siege tank change is, because whether it's just me, I feel like not being able to pick up... They can still pick up siege tanks, just not when they're in siege mode.
Correct.
So I guess it just adds a delay to that tactic rather than anything else. But
I think it's very nice of a change, honestly, because that's the... Mm. I hate that harass so much. I really do.
It does level the playing field a little bit, although we'll see once we get to the other races. But yeah, in general, I think that's all pretty smart stuff. They're just generally boosting a few things. And I agree with the energy changes to the Battlecruiser, because... It doesn't make sense to have a resource for that. But yeah, I'm pretty happy with all that. Nothing totally game-changing, I guess.
It's going to be game-changing. Then that will bring us to Protoss. So, Protoss, Tempests are going to have a much shorter range against ground units. Going from 15 down to 6. Ground damage is increased to 35. Anti-air is exactly the same as it used to be. They also did increase supply on Tempest from 4 to 6. So, and they gave Tempest a new ability. Disruption Sphere immediately launches a wall of energy that flies at target ground. Damages units and buildings in that location, deals 450 damage over 32 seconds, 43-second cooldown, area of effect radius set to 1.95 with a 13 cast range, and no friendly fire damage. So overall, I think this would be a nerf for Tempest with kind of a gimmick attached to it. I feel like they want Disruption Sphere to be better than it's actually going to end up being.
I don't know. I mean, I in my level of play anyway, I hardly even see Tempest be used anyway.
They're an incredibly endgame unit. They're what you use against Brood Lords and stuff like that, but... Zealot's research charge upgrade will now increase the Zealot's movement speed from 3.85 to 4.13. It's essentially just the idea of making them a little bit more competitive with the other two warp gate units.
Make Zealots great again.
Make Zealots great again. Carriers, they're removing the release interceptor ability. But as a trade-off, interceptors cost, instead of being 25 minerals, is 5 minerals.
This is going to be ridiculous.
Carriers are ridiculous.
We're going to see carriers. I bet we're going to see carriers at professional level now.
With that change, I wouldn't be surprised. The mineral cost has been kind of what people avoided carriers for. So
I mean, we've seen them before at a professional level, but that's when like a Protoss player is so cocky that he's winning anyway.
Yeah, or just random strategies. Even pro players feel like just messing with people on occasion. Dark Templars are now getting a blink effect, essentially. It does require a research from the Dark Shrine. It's a fairly long research time, but Dark Templars are going to be so much more cheesy.
If you thought your DT spam was annoying in the first place, now they can just dash away from your Marines or your Zerglings or whatever you're trying to defend with.
And that will be a close to the Protoss section. So what do you think on that one?
It's not a lot, not as many changes as Terran, obviously, but I really think that carrier change is a huge one. Definitely changed the way we'll see carriers being used in competitive play, seeing them more regular. And, of course, I'm very annoyed by the Dark Templar change.
I guess, in some ways, I agree, and I want to see that. I think that the general sense of getting from all of this is that they just really want to shake up some of the more traditional gameplay styles. So I guess the question to you guys is, if we start to see carriers in sort of standard Protoss play, what do Terran and Zerg players have to do to combat that?
Corruptors, a lot of corruptors.
Because
something that I don't pay attention to, and it's why I'm not platinum like Big Voodoo is, but like once I build a spire and I usually don't focus on up my air unit upgrades as much as I should, and like if you have fully upgraded corruptors, like you could definitely take out carriers.
Corruptors would be the best bet. Probably a few swarm hosts. Oh man, it's been far too long since I played StarCraft.
Hydras?
Nope, flying caster unit.
Oh, I can't. It's been far too long.
Viper.
For me too. Vipers, yeah. With their parasitic bomb ability.
Parasitic bomb, but abduct would be the biggest thing, because carriers are so slow. If you can kite. Or if you can abduct one back into corruptors, take it out, and then kind of retreat away from, you know, the rest of the carrier armada that's trying to kill you.
So you think it's going to be nothing but carriers now?
I don't think that'll actually happen, at least not very commonly, but
I guess
it's
going
to be much more common now.
I think the real thing is, as a Zerg player, is to just not let the Protoss get to the stage where they're building carriers. Is what you should focus on. Because it is still a very late game tactic. So, as a Terran player, I have no idea. I have no idea what you count it.
The appropriate response is to quit.
Yeah, GG. Carriers.
GG, I'm done.
That's true. They don't really have much to deal with. Maybe it's Cyclones.
Maybe Cyclones. Maybe just base trade. Try to base trade. If the carriers are in your base, just try to... Okay,
just run away.
We got to try to...
Or have battle cruisers, because I'm pretty sure a couple Yamato cannons will take out a carrier. And if you can reduce their numbers down pretty quickly, then it's okay.
There we go. Carriers are inferior to everything else.
They're not. To put this in perspective for everyone who doesn't know StarCraft, carriers are the highest damage unit in the entire game.
And they got a lot... It's got a lot easier
lot less
for them
expensive.
To get their damage ramped up, basically.
What, it was 200 minerals, now it's 40 minerals for a full bay of interceptors?
Yep.
Okay,
so...
All right,
moving on,
to the most important and best race in the game. And no one's going to argue with me because...
I have a Zerg tattoo.
To play Zerg.
I'm not going to argue with you.
Swarm hosts. They seem to be good, but balance isn't quite there, so
Blizzard seems like Blizzard's trying to bring Swarmhost back, because Swarmhost are literally the only unit that no Zerg player uses. Ever.
Yeah, pretty much. So they're reducing the cost from 150 minerals and 100 gas to 175, respectively. They are also increasing the range at which locusts can swoop from 4 to 6, which is a fairly hefty increase. I mean, 33% right there. Ravagers are getting the nerf bat. Getting the armored flag added on to them, which doesn't sound like a big deal, but there's a lot of units that deal plus damage versus armored, including a lot of damage that there are a lot of units that you would have used Ravagers to kind of counter before. For example, siege tanks that are now going to deal like 70 damage in a single shot.
I think this is just a change to help mix up the just Roach Ravager being pretty much every go-to strategy. I mean, some people still do Mutiling Bang in certain situations, but Roach Ravager has just been so strong since it came out, basically.
Well, and, you know, Roach Ravager has been the preferred go-to because it's just all around better. It's a lot easier to play for better results. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, this is definitely going to shake up Zerg rotation or Zerg play styles a little bit, which is good. I think sticking to one strategy as Zerg is, and I've been in the bad habit of it too. I do Roach Ravager almost every game I play. So, yeah, shaking it up would be good.
Hydralisks, they want to be a much more core unit than others previously, or than they were previously. They're increasing the attack range from 5 to 6. I'm dying over here. Their upgrade will now give an additional one range on top of that, as well as plus 25% to their base movement speed.
Both on and off.
Wow.
Yes. And then Banelings are getting a health increase from 30 to 40.
This is huge. That means you can actually run your Banelings into a line of Marines, and some of them will get there.
Yes. Also, thinking about it, sorry, I have to double check math. 40 damage. I have to go back up to where this information is.
It's just the theme tune whenever Big Voodoo calculates something.
All right. So,
okay.
Now, if you get armor 1 for ground on them as well, they will not get one shot by siege tanks.
So this, and especially if you get the speed buff to Banelings, Banelings are going to be very strong, which is awesome, because I love a Baneling style play. I need to get better at my Baneling micro anyway, so them being a viable strategy, hey,
there we go. Yeah.
I'm almost upset that these changes are coming out here so soon, because it's like, Legion's right around the corner, and now I really want to play StarCraft.
Right? And then Infestors are getting some love with a new ability called Deep Tunnel. 50 mana, and it allows them to teleport anywhere that they have sight on the minimap. Sure. It will provide an audible warning when it happens, though.
I think this is nice. I mean, I don't know. I hardly ever use Infestors, which, again, something that makes me not a Platinum player as a Zerg. but maybe I'll start using them more. Just
They're worth it, especially...
So could that be used to just harass supply lines?
Yes, it could. But
I didn't even think about that. You just have an Overlord and then just drop an Infestor, fungal
Or just spawn a couple... Infested Terran, cheaper. Yeah. And frankly, Infested Terran do a crap ton of damage against things like
mineral lines. So
give your opponent a real headache every however many minutes.
Yeah.
That's really nasty.
So, yeah, these changes, these are... And of course, you've the Broodlord there at the end. Just a little reintroduction from 11 to 10.
Yeah. Ooh. Essentially, they wanted it to match the Thor's anti-air attack, which makes sense. Thor's are kind of what they're going for to counter Broodlords, it seems.
So, because these changes, they are big changes. They are definitely going to affect balance. They are not actually going live until after BlizzCon.
That makes sense.
Makes sense.
Because they, like, you definitely have to be changing major strategies, major ways of thinking, and we're already a good way through the tournaments this year. So we're already getting qualifiers for BlizzCon. So
I think
it would be weird to shake it up. Though it doesn't make sense for World of Warcraft because the qualifiers have been happening for those in Warlords, and yet it's going to be Legion gameplay at Legion.
Well, they've had the beta to play around with, and
but that's Warcraft. Nobody cares about Warcraft esports. So.
Exactly.
So, if I wanted to go back to StarCraft, I only have one question: which team do I choose to win? Which is best?
Which race?
The game is so balanced. Yeah. I mean, I would say if you're new to StarCraft, play Terran.
It really depends on like. What you're best at in a game or in an RTS, because there are certain like abilities that become much better for different people. Like I am trash with Terran because my ability to control and split units and stuff like that is lacking.
I'm very good at like macro. I'm building bases. I'm very good at maintaining supply lines and stuff. That's why I play Zerg, because it's macro is such an important part of their gameplay, and because I can maintain it pretty well. I'm not a terrible Zerg player. Not Matt.
Yeah. What?
I'm not,
what was that?
I'm not you.
Okay. you did once.
Three times.
That on your
three
board.
Times. Three times.
Three whole times. How many times have you lost?
I don't know.
lost count.
Anyway. What you were saying about what he should play?
But, yeah, like, it's all what you excel at in an RTS. If you're really good at reading the other person's movements, Zerg is great. If you're good at managing a bunch of different units... Protoss is great. All of them can be obviously top tier competitive because all of them are, but
One thing I have to suggest for new players too is don't play against the AI unless you're just really trying to get a basic core understanding of how the game works. Is that's how you should play against the AI? Once you understand your macros, your key bindings, and just kind of how to control the game, just start playing against people, because the AI will never give you what an actual game feels like, ever. I mean, even if you're good at the game, you'll lose to the AI because they just know what you're doing and it just reacts the way people don't. You'll just get a much better feel for the game just hopping into, even if you don't want to hop into ranked, play quick play.
Yeah.
And if you can't beat the AI?
I oftentimes can't beat the AI. I mean, the AI is, it's crazy.
So here's a funny fact. I'm a platinum player. Tarly is... bronze or silver or gold?
I've gotten to gold, so I'm a gold level player. We'll see.
Okay. Then he more consistently was beating AI when he was at gold level than I do now at platinum, because AI is so different than playing actual people.
Yeah. And you can, again, start off playing against the AI because it kind of goes into its own ranking system. You queue up against it, and then it just gets harder and harder. The more you win. So you're starting off, it'll be pretty easy to play against the AI. But as you get better, the AI gets better, and then it just gets ridiculous. So. All right. I think we have talked about StarCraft 2 for a long time. We'll briefly touch on our other discussion topic we wanted to talk about, and that is the rise and the fall of the Warcraft movie, and is there any hope for us to actually see a sequel? So we've all heard the bustling success out of China. It had like what, close to $200 million made just from China alone, and just international sales dominated versus US's bombing, basically. We can call it a bomb. Under 50 million, was it not? Or
I think it's about $44 million domestic total. Or something.
And you'd think that you look at the $150 million budget and you think it came out on top, but a lot of people missed the marketing and all this advertising for the movie as well. Warcraft ended up coming at a $50 to $70 million loss for the studios altogether. So this has a lot of people doubting whether we will see a Warcraft sequel. What do you guys think? And this isn't, I mean, of course we all want it. We would love a Warcraft sequel, but do you think we'll actually get one?
No, I don't. As much as I hate it, it's always going to be about the money, and it didn't make money, it lost money, and not exactly just a little bit either.
Yeah.
So
$50 million. Yeah.
Yeah. It's not likely.
In some ways, I'm looking at, I don't know if I said this before, but I said that the curse of these films is always that they end up like the Golden Compass, and that they plan for three, they get one. And the Golden Compass had a budget of $180 million and pulled in $372 million. I don't know what that equates once you take in all the various things, whether that's a loss or not, but I think, yeah, maybe Voodoo's right. In some ways, I feel like they could do it because a lot of the money went into those resources that we spoke about earlier with the models, the character models, and the props and the custom, the world building, and all the CGI that went into that, and they could reuse a lot of that. So that takes out a huge cost. Whether the studios actually say, right, we'll give you less of a budget because you've already made some of those assets. It depends whether Warcraft 2 could be made at, you know, on $60 million. If it could be made
it's
on $60 million.
I mean, the way these animation studios work, I mean, like Duncan Jones and his team basically just went to ILM. They hired them as a whole separate contract, basically, and they pay a certain amount of money per shot, per animated shot. So, like, no matter what, they're going to have to pay ILM again. Even if they have the assets, they'd have to pay ILM again per shot that they needed in the movie. And I can't think of a shot in Warcraft that didn't have CGI going on somewhere, of one way or another. And I know, like, Duncan Jones said that in the second one, if he was going to do one, he'd want to do Torin and all of that. So, I mean, that most likely, if they were to do an under-budgeted Warcraft 2, you probably wouldn't see something like that happen. I agree with Big Voodoo. I don't think we're going to see it. We're not even going to get an extended edition of the first movie. Duncan Jones said on Twitter that it wasn't possible. He didn't say why it wasn't possible, but when asked, he said, yeah, it was an impossibility. So it's definitely sad. You know, I loved the movie personally, and really wanted to see Warcraft explode as a movie franchise. And it didn't.
I mean, I don't know whether DVD and Blu-ray sales add into the factors. I mean, do they count towards whether the studios would actually consider refinancing?
If it does really, really well, I think it could. But I think the people who saw the movie are going to be the same ones who buy the movie.
Yeah. Do you think it's the reviews as well that add to it, or is it just simply the money?
I think
the money.
I think it's the money.
Yeah.
I think money is.
Yeah, I mean, if
money
the reviews
is the reason.
Negative. Yeah. Go on.
If the reviews were negative, but it grossed, like, if they made, say, $100 million on it, and the review says it was bad, they're going to look at them and be like, yeah, maybe it was bad, but it's a cash cow. Let's make another.
Yeah. Look at Call of Duty lately. I mean,
yeah. The game's terrible, but it makes money, yeah. So let's make another.
Well, don't say that about the new one. That's still getting its fair share of controversy.
Yeah, that might not make as much money. But anyway, yeah, you're right. I mean, ultimately, Hollywood is a business, and Warcraft was a failed investment. So it just probably won't happen again. Unless other studios back it. That's the thing. There were three studios. There was a Chinese studio, there was Legendary Pictures, and there was Universal. So unless other studios came and picked it up, like we saw kind of like with The Hobbit, got some different ones than New Line Cinema from Lord of the Rings, basically. If something like that happened with Warcraft, some other guys said, hey, we're going to change the marketing, we're going to budget the film a different way, and we're going to make it, I just don't see it happening.
I think that there's that political issue, which is like when the film came out and it did so well in China.
Yeah.
I think it, even Jackie Chan came out and said, you know what, this just shows how much power the Chinese markets have, how much the Chinese movie industry has. And he said, well, if we've got this amount of power, then why aren't we the ones setting the standards and saying to Hollywood, listen, you can come and finance our films.
Yeah.
And I think that's a point. I think in a sense, you couldn't rely on China to buy into it, because the Chinese movie industry wants to make their own films and sell them over here. So you're right, maybe that third Chinese studio wouldn't back it this time. Yeah. So it's political as well, I guess, to some extent.
Definitely.
But you know, it's still a good movie, and I think, you know, it was still worth bringing out for whatever reason.
I mean, I'm gonna buy it absolutely when it comes out on Blu-ray. I will own that movie, even though I may have downloaded a copy from China and whatever. I mean, I think it's a fantastic movie, and I will absolutely spend the money to own a copy and have it, you know, at least have the one movie that we got from it. At least the fans loved it, and Duncan Jones did a phenomenal job despite how the sales go. And yeah.
Yeah, well, it was, at least for fan service, it was a great movie. Yeah. Like, it may not have been a great movie for critics and, you know, professional moviegoers.
Yeah.
Just stupid that that's a thing. But for the people that it was made for, it was great.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and spin it on its head. Oh, sorry, go on, Tali.
I was just going to say, if we hear anything of a second one, it will probably be a BlizzCon.
Yeah.
It could happen. Duncan Jones, you know, Mike Warheim could just quickly turn during his intro speech to Duncan Jones on screen, who announces they're starting development on Warcraft 2.
Because Blizzard should fund it.
Blizzard probably could fund it very easily. I mean, they lost, what, $40 million? They can make that up in 1 month with WoW.
Exactly.
what do you mean? That's a day's pay in Hearthstone. And half of that's from you, Big Voodoo.
Maybe.
I guess to flip it on its head quickly, if Blizzard was to, like, either do, you know, part finance another film, or to give out one of its licenses for something other than WoW to do a movie, which movie do you think would do best? Would it be like StarCraft? Do you think an Overwatch movie would do well,
yes,
given the success?
Absolutely. An animated Warcraft, or an animated Overwatch film. Absolutely.
I think that would be the highest probability of success. Yeah. Because Overwatch is actually popular.
The game's at 15 million players. Jeez.
And it sounds like as well they've got that maybe not to do it to that extent, they'd have to bring in help, but they've clearly got that capacity, that ability in-house to make these. So
they would. I would assume they would have to hire on more to do a full movie project, but because like they can release a cinematic once every few months or so. So a whole movie would be a pretty big undertaking while keeping up cinematics going for all their other universes.
It'd be a great way to expand on the lore without, you know, having to rely on the comics too much. You know, they could talk about the whole war that happened before and things like that. That'd be pretty amazing.
So, yeah, forget Warcraft. Blizzard, just invest more into Overwatch. I mean, I'm not saying a live-action Overwatch wouldn't be great, too. I mean, that'd be nuts, but
that would be interesting.
Yeah, I guess they could do a live-action Overwatch pretty easily.
Just get the girl who played Harley Quinn to play Tracer.
Or Widow.
Or Widowmaker. Either way.
Probably Widow might be better.
Yeah. She's not French,
I think, wasn't there that
she sounds more like a Tracer.
I've never heard her voice, I think. Oh, I don't know. I'll have to check it out.
Yeah. Anyway, that's our thoughts on the Warcraft movie there. Sorry to go all depressing and sad, make all of our listeners very sad about the Warcraft sequel.
Wait till BlizzCon. Let's see what happens at BlizzCon.
We do not, I mean, we usually accurately predict stuff, but not always. Not always. We could be wrong this time for once.
But it won't happen.
Since we've gone pretty long here for the show, I'll save my Prince's Gaze for next week's episode. It's not a pressing matter. Any shout outs for the Heroes Call?
A shout out to everyone on Twitter who very aptly reminded me that Varian is in about a million bits right now and he's never coming back, and that hurts my soul.
A shout out to Charlie, my dog, sitting next to me throughout this entire episode. Thank you, Woo! Charlie.
I got nothing.
Official Geeks of Azeroth mascot. You have to dress him up now, Tarly.
I do. For the viewers who watch, I'll just move the camera down. There he is. Sweet boy.
Oh. I want to see him in a Genji outfit next time.
All right. Well, without further ado, I think it's time we wrap up the show. Thank you, everyone, for listening. As always, you can check us out on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, and Twitch. You can check us out on Twitter at Geeks of Azeroth. You can find me personally at Tarly underscore Paws. Where can we find you, Britza?
You can find me at Britza underscore EG.
Big Voodoo.
At B1GV00D00.
And, of course, you can always contact the show with your messages, questions, shout-outs, your love for Big Voodoo's knee. Send all of that to geeksofazerothEG@gmail.com. Otherwise, we'll be back same place, same time next week. Have a great week in Azeroth. Kill some demons!